家在这个又湿又冷的早晨啊，从那个温暖的被窝里面爬出来的，是不是？啊，我先来讲一下我们这个会议的缘起哈。啊，因为我们政大拿到一个很大的一个深耕计划，那我是属于应用伦理的那个研究群。啊，那我想就说我们将来要办国际会议，但是如果我们没有先凝聚一个方向、一些问题的共识的话，国际会议不是那么容易就办出来的。所以我希望说呢，我们可以就佛教伦理，我们先办几个工作坊，然后办国内会议，然后呢，我们再来办国际会议，哈，就是我们自己先准备好，然后再跟国际学者哈有一个这样的交流。不过我们也可以看到，从我们今天的作品里面就可以看到，在那个 gender 性别伦理这个议题，我们其实早就很国际化了，大家都可以看到戴爱玲老师啊、小泉法师，还有那个 Christine 啊、萨拉迪卡。所以我觉得所以这个工作坊的目的其实不是在发表新作，而是说我们可以就各个就是就关心这个性别议题的学者啊，他们都学有专精，他们可以在方法学、在开发议题方面，或者对于西方他们怎么来看这些问题，跟我们台湾怎么看这个问题，种种的这种比较。好，我觉得这个是一个可以跟专家直接面对面对他的这个文章来讨论，而且我们在座的人其实各有专业哈，那有一点点背景是 overlap 有点相关的，这样讨论起来其实反而可以免去前面的一些摸索哈，我们就直接来讨论这个问题。所以我觉得这是我们工作坊的一个目的。所以我们这个工作坊的设计，大家可以发现哈，我们非常注重讨论，非常注重讨论。那我们等一下第二个阶段呢，我们会来分群讨论。好，针对我们会先请啊两位作者呢，我都称呼他们为作者或者是学者的哈，他们先发表大概他们对于他们的研究的一个回顾哈。那大家可以看到他的论文，然后也有他们个人的一些发表意见，然后我们来自由讨论。讨论完了之后呢，第二个阶段呢，我们再回到这边来，然后呢，再请苏美文老师好做主持，然后把每一个小组的问题呢集合在一起。那我有一个先说的哈，就是说我们在讨论的时候，因为是以讨论为主，所以非常的自由。那如果说有人讨论哈，他提出了这个问题，他就是举一，就是我的这个新的议题，我就举一。那如果接下来有人想要举出另外一个新的议题，你就举二。但是如果说你是想要 follow 前面那个一，原来比较早那个议题，你就举一。那我们就请苏美文老师，就是把一的都先捡起来，好，因为有的人可能不在这一组，可是他可能在他们那一组，他们的相同的类似的意见，他就可以就是跟着。所以如果你要发表就是第讨论阶段的时候，你每一我们原则上是每一组报告，但是如果他讲的他是第一个讲，那你有要 follow up 你举一啊，如果没有一的话我们就继续二了，就新的意见了，就那个啊。如果那个苏美文老师觉得一太多了啊，算了啦，我们现在二也可以。 OK， 好，这就是我们在我们的技术上有一点这样的不同。好，那我们下午还会有那个自奈老师，自奈法师已经到了，那林美容老师还没有到，他会有一个总的一个检讨。那林美容老师为什么请他来哈？因为大家都很清楚他做什么研究。哎，他做过女神马祖，对不对？他也做过斋宫，他也做过那个寺庙里面的养女，就是那个宜兰的占卜的。民间信仰的，所以他几乎他所接触到的女性的宗教形态呢是非常非常广的。所以我们也希望邀请一个类似不同领域可是研究很相似的人哈，这样子。然后如果我们今天有时间的话，我也请大家记在心里面，因为我们第一次办，可是我们希望将来可以 follow up， 可以继续，所以大家也可以互相讨论建议一下我们下一次办什么，可以很快，可以十一月就办，或者明年下学期再办一次都可以。那我觉得，佛教性别研究哈， 在台湾可能不是很受到重视，啊，因为我们台湾的这个，我们刚才谈台湾的学界，啊，学生对于佛教有一定的想象，他们对于佛教的想象大部分就是 scripture， 然后呢就是 golden date in the past 或是怎么之类的，就说但是我们看到，啊，现在这个伦理这个议题其实已经非常非常重要，啊，若而且不是只有学校里面的，大家若有兴趣的话，看看明年还有今年十二月佛光山已经在办佛教的管理伦理，然后明年那个圣严法师逝世十周年，他们开出来的是心理社会医心理经济跟医疗，所以大家都已经在走在前面去开这个新的领域，所以我觉得伦理这个议题是非常非常的重要哈。那也许这里面除了那个佛教的 imagination 之外，还有一个问题就是当代佛教、近代佛教的研究哈，非常的这个少哈。那我跟那个何建明还有那个陈建华，我们今年一月我们在香港要办一个中国与近代佛教论坛。提供给国硕士学生，啊，去参加，然后我们会提供导师，然后我们会来回机票加五天的所有的食宿费用，啊，我们也都希望能够多找一些好的学生开始研究近代佛教，好，这个都是一个很新的一个趋势，啊，那但是大部分我想80%的学生可能还在做经典，还是所谓的主流，所以呢，我非常非常鼓励哈，在场的各位同学哈，赶快先去做那个80%还没有被开发的领域，好，我觉得这个值得努力了哈。好，那我们今天就直接就开始，好，我们先请两位讲者，谁要开始？先开始，每个人20分钟跑不掉 ，OK。啊，结果长城法师啊，好，我们就先请长城法师，好，啊，后面可以帮我们进行，好，
来，谢谢，我就做了吗？还是
都可以，我做了，你们做得了，好，
长城法师需要用电脑吗？
不用了，不用了。
对啊，觉得因为我这两年在国外，所以才刚回到台湾有多远，一回到台湾就觉得伦理真的不一样，非常那个恭敬的人，因为在国外状况其实是就是以僧人这样的身份出现的时候，其实是有很多有趣的经验，对，比如说不知道你是男众还是女众，然后或者是那个，还有就是说，还是如果在，因为是在神学院嘛，所以还是就是说，还是蛮开心的。大家看到一个佛教的主讲人在那，可是基本上还是用一个比较，就是啊，很有趣啊。如果你要表现很亲切的话，他会觉得就是可以跟你当朋友，他很高兴，因为你跟其他人不一样这样。可是基本上就因为他们，美国的佛教还是就是说三宝的概念还在。生根当中这样，好，那谢谢，好，感觉，哦，台湾真好，好。然后那这一篇其实，我想大家都看过，我就不太多说了。那我只是就是那个，就是讲一下，就是为什么有这那时候有这个问题意识，想要讨论大丈夫，因为其实也是因为，我想这一篇可能牵扯到一个，就是说东西方学者怎么看待性别跟佛教。还有就是比如说像大丈夫这样的议题，然后第二就是经典跟实践当中，就是我们阅读经典会影响信徒的行为嘛，那可是真的经典所代表的概念跟实践者真的就实践者的实际的做法真的如经典所说的吗？那这也是一个值得探讨。那当然还有另外就是做学者学界跟真的田野实际的状况也是一个也是要值得探讨，所以这个大概这篇会牵扯到这三个 之前比较是有点二分的状态，那现在这一天会牵扯到这个，能打破这个二分这样子。那我其实刚才为什么会讨论这个，就是因为我在看一些西方在研究禅宗跟女性的经典的时候，那当然这些都是比较文献的。那因为这样子的经典已经很记录已经很少，就所谓的女禅师或者是就是等等，就是中国曾经出现一些女性禅师，那他们当然就是在经里面会看到用大丈夫形容他们这些人这样子。那可是后来就发现，在英文的里面，就是学者里面，英文里面他们会对大丈夫翻译成，就是说是 heroic man 或 great man。那这当中其实我就也 OK 了，反正英文也不是很好，所以就这样，他这样翻译也蛮有趣。可是会发现说，西方学者有很大的批评，就是说他觉得这样子，就是说为什么把大丈夫女性说你修得很好叫大丈夫，然后说意思就是说为什么用一个男性的代名词来形容女性，好像是否定她的性别，也否定她这个就是所有的，就是说好像就是说以男性作为一个就是说好像说你修行得很好，那你就变成男的这样子。就是说，所以大丈夫其实是一个男性的词，为什么会去形容一个女性这样子？所以就会很强烈的批评说，禅宗里面是一个性别阶级非常严重，然后还有女性是一个二等公民，然后女性的声音没有办法被呈现，然后女性的声音就是说就是说没有办法被呈现，这样没有让女性有一个能动性，这样主体性呈现不出来。那作为一个现代的，那因为我是高山人嘛，那才是一个禅宗道场，那我对于这样子的一个评论我非常的惊讶，因为我觉得我的声音有没有被表达出来吗？就说 那我会觉得说，哎，奇怪，为什么会西方学者是这样看待就是禅宗的性别议题这样子。对，那所以那当然我觉得对过去的那样批评是非常非常正确的，可是因为的确在文献里面，其实像景德传跟有1700多个禅师，就只有一个女众。对，那当然就是其实是很明显。可是我总之看了这样子的一个学说之后，我是觉得有一点很大的疑惑，然后我就开始觉得说，如果我们平常在我们在其他法师啊，我们在形容彼此的时候，的确我们也是说啊，谁有大丈夫像谁怎样，然后我就想说，难道我们这样也是一种就是被污染的一种，就是说一种概念吗？那我就想说，可是我又觉得说，我们在形容一个大丈夫，我们没有觉得说这位女众法师有大丈夫像是表示说她变得男的，就是她有男性的特质，我们也不是那个意思。所以我就开始觉得，那倒是我个人还是其他的僧众也有这样子的，女性的僧众也有这样子的想法，那我就去问了一个，那他们就觉得没有啊，大丈夫没有叫你变成男的啊，那大丈夫就当丈夫，大丈夫是一个中性，是超越的一个性别的一个概念。然后我才觉得说啊，那我觉得这可以去做一个探讨。所以我就大概就是说，基本上这一篇就是用一个那个就是一个词源的一个所谓的系谱学啊，就是那个福柯那个系谱学，就是一个去找说大丈夫这个词，它因为是汉译的经典，它毕竟前面有一些从泛译过来的，泛文过来的，那就去找回去大丈夫的那个词，其实就是那个 Mahapurusha。 那 Mahapurusha 这个词的意思本来是那个，就是它有两个意思，一个是它的确就是指男性，它是一个良心代名词；第二个就是它是指一个神物，就是说 cosmology 面就是一个超越的那种，比如说叫梵还是嘎这样，对，就是梵那样存在，它没有什么，它都还不是，它都不一定是人格化，所以它没有性格的概念。所以那可是当然，第一个就是印度，它本来那个时候就用嘛 purusha mahapurusha 这个词来形容那一种修行，佛教里面修道有成的状态的时候，那比如说好像佛的32相里面有一个大丈夫像，或什么，他就已经用这个词，所以这个词本身已经有一个，它又既代表中性，稍微又有男性的意涵的这样一个代名词。那所以中文那时候翻译马哈弗鲁侠变成大丈夫的时候，其实也是有，其实也很有意思，就是他其实用中文来翻译，就还 蛮正确的方法，所以他可是这样的，正确的意思其实也把这样子两个意思都带过来，一个它代表是一个超越的，或是一种修行的一个，就是就精神更高的存在。可是另外一方面，它也有那性别的意涵，也就带过来讲。那所以那这篇基本上就是说去 argue 说，其实啊。当我们今年说啊，什么大丈夫等等的，其实它指的是一个，就是说是修道有成的状态，然后包括男性跟女性，我们是讲男性，所以那个意思就不是说我们变成大丈夫是说哦，你要转成男啊或等等的这样子的一种概念这样子，因为它原来那个词的意思其实就是有中性的概念这样子。然后那第二个部分当然就是说。回到就是说那个，就是也做了一些访谈，就是说，的确就是去证明说，当代传统女性她其实她并不是把大丈夫理解，成为大丈夫理解成是一个转女从变成男性等等的这样子一个访谈这样子。对，那那所以就是说，当然这样子的东西，也包括也就有些人会质疑，就是说，那当然我们也可以去发明说，那既然这样，我们为什么还要用大丈夫？我们可不可以用别的词来形容比较中性的词，或比较甚至是女性的比较真正的一个词来形容一种修道有成的状态？那当然是很好，那我们可以去创造这种语言这样子。对，那当然也有人比较批评的，就当然这篇这样论述现在是很清楚。就是说，大家不会对大丈夫这个词再有一个，就是说，这次会比较清楚。可是另外也有人会去质疑说，那我们法师能互相彼此称还是称呼师兄吗？为什么要说师兄？你都是女众，为什么叫师兄？那这一点我也很话说，就是的确，我觉得这样的东西是一个，虽然语言本身或许到当代已经。我们虽然是隐私有一个男性的意涵，可是我们已经用的是一个所谓的通称，就 generic， 它不是一个 male pronoun， 就是男性代名词。我们的用法已经没有他性别成分，可是它还是毕竟作为语言，它还是因为语言代表有文化，它一直在复制。那这样子是不是也一直在复制这样一种概念？还是说它还是会去淡化这个性别的，就是这种区分啊？不知道这样，所以这篇其实是，就是其实是蛮真发表出来的时候，其实有人非常喜欢，有人觉得非常的觉得说，就是说非常的也是有些比如说质疑啊，对，那不过基本上就是，不过我觉得能够引起一个很强烈的讨论的文章，其实应该都还是蛮有趣的，这样子非常好，谢谢。
Well, thank you so much. I want to, I'm going to speak English because if I use Chinese, I will make a total mess. So I'll speak slowly and clearly. I hope this works. But I want to thank Director Lee, for inviting me to this wonderful workshop and also thank her.For arranging me, this semester I am here at Zhengda. I'm very lucky to have gotten the Shengyan Foundation Visiting Fellow, and that's why I'm here at Zhengda this semester. But I will be in Taiwan next semester too, so I'm happy to help you. So, may I sit down? So, well,I would like to tell you where this paper came from. Originally, it was AAS paper. I presented it. There was a panel about Buddhist women in Chinese history, and Professor Yao Ping invited me to talk about Chinese women in modern times. So I had already studied something about Taiwan Buddhist women, and now I did research about Chinese women, mostly about early 20th century, so Mingguo Shidai. So that's why I wrote this paper. And when I was writing this paper, I suddenly realized that, as you see in the first paragraph, I have been struck by the wide networks that reformist Buddhist women and men built. I started to make a list of people, geographic areas, temples, and Buddhist schools. And I found it was amazing. Even in early 20th century, we have nuns and monks, but they went so many places. Sichuan, Taishan, they went to Beijing, Manchuria, even Tibet, Taiwan, Fujian, Hong Kong, and Japan. So I think that's an interesting thing about modern Buddhist nuns, that they're making all these networks, even in Japan, as we know. And this is even before 1949. So I think that's a really important, and that's touching upon what Professor Jung will talk about. How we sometimes think, oh, Buddhism in China is just in China, or Taiwan is just Taiwan, but they had lots of interactions, even before 1949. Now, I'm not saying that all the nuns did that, because my materials, it's sort of like a self-selected group. These nuns, all, we have a lot of information about them, and, you know, they were the kind of nuns that went to many places. So there are many nuns I don't know about. Maybe some nuns never left their temple, right? So I must admit that I'm not saying every nun was international or going around China, but I was really surprised to see these nuns. And I thought, what would a study, if we studied these networks that already started in early 20th century and then developed, what would that tell us about modern Chinese Buddhism? I thought we could just look at the networks, and already we know that. So networks, let me, I have to write in the book. So networks, it's not a new topic. Let me see. Everyone knows about Holmes Welch, the famous, there's an American scholar, he already passed away. What was it? How do you say that in Chinese? He wrote 3 books about Chinese Buddhism. Welch, one about early 20th century Buddhism, one about, I think 2 about traditional and 20th century Buddhism, and one about post-1949. Yeah, although, so it's kind of interesting, it's but very early. He passed away in the 70s. So he talked about networks, and he did not call them networks. He said affiliations. So I think network is from a science. It's from science field, network. So he did not use that word. He said affiliation. But you may know that Holmes Welch talked about monks, not nuns. He even said, I am a man, it's not convenient for me. Which is probably true, right? But I, quite frankly, I think he wasn't interested in women. He didn't say it, but so affiliation, so religious, so kinship. So we're talking about traditional monks. Religious kinship, so the monks who together, ti du, or the monks who were ordained together, right, the same generation, or the monks, they work together, like translating things. So this is traditional. Also, loyalty, he said loyalty. Well, that's hard to define. It's maybe, obviously to your master, but other masters too. Yeah, lineage, but even cross-lineage. For example, I have one master, but I have another master. So, you know, it's almost, it's a Chinese or, you know, loyalty.
And then the last one is...
So, you may know this, there's Jiangzhe, there's Minnan, there's, you know, Beijing, there's... if I'm from this area, I just, my connections are mostly in that area. Tongxiang, yeah, Tongxiang, or even just from the temples, like Jiangnan, right? There's many temples there. Or even in Taiwan, right? There's not a Beibu and Nanbu. I'm talking about 19th century. So he talked about that. And the next one is... So once again, he did not talk about nuns. Then there's the next one. It's like I'm teaching class. Sorry, I have to write everything down. Then there's another, maybe there's other people too, but... I think these, Wank is an American, and Ashiwa is Japanese American. So 2005, and they wrote an article. An article, they're looking at networks of clergy and devotees. So, 出家人跟他们的弟子在家中, overseas, so China and all over the world. So they looked at 20th century monks, nuns, and the lay people, and how they have. So, for example, Taiwan has a lot of activity now in China. I was in China for 3 years, and in one city, many of the Chinese temples were being rebuilt because of Taiwan money. I guess you know that, right? Yeah. So that's an interesting thing. So money or a lot of donations, right? And not just China and Taiwan, but well, you know this, like Singapore, traditionally, right? There's a lot of money flowing around, or people too. Well, you know that, like people go around to spread the Dharma. So they were talking about that. Now, neither of them talked about nuns. Ashiwar and Wang, they just said clergy, right? Clergy means, well, it's a Christian term, right? It's clergy means monks and nuns, but he did not talk about nuns. So that's why I said, what if we looked at nuns' networks? What would happen? So, now, how do you do it? You could make I made a list of these nuns that I wrote about. And there's many ways you can just talk about it in your paper, or you could make a map. So how do you make a map of all these connections? So if you see on page 80, it should be color. I think when it was, it actually should be a color one. But, so that is a network map, a very simple one. The original one is color. You need to have the color. But, so, this is what I came up with. It was myself and their special software for this. There's a software, and I had someone to help me when I was at Duke. Does everyone know Duke? Duke Dashi. And they're very famous for their something called digital humanities. Have you heard about that? Yeah. So this is a big, It's a new way of looking at, everyone knows humanities, right? So it's literature, history, arts. And what you do is, usually we, in humanities, we write about it, which is great. But you can also use different tools, different software, and things like that to talk about your story. So when you write a story, like about nuns, you can write about it, but it's interesting if you can use some software, Rantima, and it, you know, show the networks using some software. So I learned a little bit about this. And digital means that, yeah, different software. And the person that's really great about this is Marcus Bingenheimer. I think some of you know him. He used to be at Fabushan. Bingenheimer? I don't know what his Chinese name is. So he's the digital humanities Buddhist guy. So look up his work. He now is in America, but he has used digital humanities to talk Buddhism. So he's at Temple University. You can go online and find his. So he's great because he developed a lot of software. So for example, Putoshan. So there's many pilgrimages, right? We know many people go there in Chaosheng. You can talk about Chaosheng, but he made a map, a historical map, saying throughout history you can see who went to Putoshan and why. And so it's a different way of looking at it. He also has this huge database about the Fujianiga Simiang. So in history, you have many temples, right? You can write it in a chart, or you can show it through time. So you have one temple, and what happened to that temple over time. So he puts in a lot of information, a lot of data, that comes up with databases or maps that you can follow through time. So it's sort of hard to explain this without giving you examples, but usually with digital humanities, you should have lots and lots and lots of data. So I did not have a lot of data, right? I just talked about Longnian and Nenghai, like Longnian's teacher, and Zhenhua, and Taishu, and some of the Longnian, Wu Yin Fa Shi, Bai Sheng, Zheng Yan, Tian Yi. So, and I found out that they have all these relationships, which we know that. We know that Wu Yin's teacher is Tian Yi, right? We know that. But there's different ways that you can map the relationships. So what I did was, I used a tiny, tiny bit of this digital humanities to try to look at networks of nuns. And I found that, you know how Holmes Welch said, monks, the affiliations of monks are religious kinship, loyalty, and regional affiliation. But for modern nuns, I found some new affiliations. So some of it could be for monks, but I don't care.
So classmates, right? Classmates in
schools. So, before the 20th century, do we have Buddhist schools? We have like Bosho, again, before the 19th century. 是不是你以前有没有博学渊源？ Probably not, right? Not in the sense. So I thought, this is a modern tie. This is a modern, you know, people who went to the same 博学渊源, now they're classmates, 同学嘛 And then you can't, you know, before modern times, you don't have that. You have, you know, because you're in the same ordination, but that's what I thought, maybe it's a new thing to have Buddhist schools. So you're a classmate now. That makes it.
Teacher and student.
So I'm from Fagushan, but I go to America to get a, and my teachers, I have teachers in America, or I'm from Shangguangsi, and either I go to my own Shangguang's Buddhist Institute, or maybe I go to Fagushan. So that's a new thing. I actually have teachers. Or
work colleagues, so
like the 14 way or whatever. You know, your 你们是同事呢 maybe they come from different temples, but now they work together. So that's an organization. Yeah, or 3 minutes, okay. that's cool. So that's one thing. It's a new kind of network, right? Because I don't think in 19th century or before they have. Yeah, I mean, maybe they work together translating something, but that's a modern organization, like the, you know, 中国佛学会 or something, new organizations.
Obviously, the other thing is transnational.
Because, you know, just think of Buddhism as a world religion now. Now, we had that before because like a lot of Taiwan nuns went to Japan to study. Remember that? We already have some of it. And, or they went somewhere else to study or something. But it seems more and more. I mean, Taiwan has helped so much, like 国际化, 国教国际化, like Taiwan. And I, not surprisingly, I found the nuns in this paper, somehow they all are connected to Tai Xu somehow. It's so, whether that's good or bad. So if you see, in the center we have Longlian, and then Tai Xu, the circles, 越大的圈,越大的, there's 越多的关系。So I have to stop, but you'll have to get the color version of this. But type of affiliation on the right-hand side, and then you can see the bigger the circle, the more people they have, and the color tells you what kind of affiliation. So I have to stop, but the whole point of this is to focus on nuns' networks and new kind of networks, new. So some of them might be applicable to monks, but I just want to talk about nuns. So thank you so much, and please tell me if I'm wrong, if I'm right, what other type of affiliations we could think about. So thank you so much.
你说到那个法古的图书馆去，全部都可以上网查，但是他们那边的图书馆的那个没有读他们那个城市读那个的城市，你是政大的学生，要先在我们自己的学校download那个城市，然 然后去他那边用自己的电脑看资料，全部的很早很早，超过十年。因为马德伟是到台湾来做 field work 的，他的 PhD 是应顺导师，然后他的第一份工作就在火化炉山。OK， 好，我们接下来要来讨论哈，那我们基本上希望大概有六个人一组这样，好不好？我们这边几个人，一二三四五六七八九十十一十二十三十四十五，还是我们差不多五个人一组，好不好？三组，然后上面有一间教室，然后两组在这边。然后我们现在从哪一边开始？我们从长生法师，你请你报号码好不好？你是一，然后二三啊，苏佩文老师是一二，然后这位同学你是三，然后你是一好二，然后你是三一三。一、二、三 ，OK， 好，那我们各位第一组。